Thanks to Brilliant for sponsoring this video and supporting my channel. Over the course of a couple of days last week, I put together this little song that you're hearing and watching on the screen right now. I composed it, I recorded it, I mixed it on my computer, and then I shot this little music video which tied together the entire thing. And I am absolutely stoked that I actually finished this song, because even though I've been playing guitar for more than 10 years, and even though I have wanted to be a musician for a very long time, I find it very difficult to actually finish music projects. I get song ideas all the time. If you look at my voice notes app on my phone, there are literally hundreds of voice memos that are me just singing song ideas into my phone. I am very good at starting music projects. I'm very good at having ideas. I'm not so good at finishing those projects and actually putting them out into the world. And I know that this is not something that is unique to me, and it is not something that is unique to musicians. A lot of people, including probably you if you clicked on this video, have trouble finishing the projects that they start. In your case, it might be a book that you're trying to write, or an art project you're trying to finish, or maybe even a YouTube channel you're trying to get off the ground. Whatever it is, if you're anything like me, you start off with a great idea and a lot of energy, but eventually you get into the project and you're so inundated with choices that you could make that you just feel paralyzed. You fall victim to what's called analysis paralysis, and that leads to you never finishing, and in many cases, abandoning the project. And while there may be other factors to blame here, I truly believe it is the abundance of choice more than any other factor that causes most of us to abandon the projects we start, especially personal projects that don't have real deadlines. Too much choice can make us unproductive. It can paralyze us. There's actually scientific evidence to back this up. Back in 2000, to just give you one example, there was a study done where they set up these two booths for people to sample different types of jams in supermarkets. One booth had only 6 types of jam to sample, and the other booth had 24. Now, the booth that had 24 jams had 150% more visitors, but only 3% of those people actually bought a jar of jam. Meanwhile, over at the booth that just had 6 types of jam, 30% of the people who walked up and tried something ended up buying a jar and going home with it. And if too much choice can affect our buying decisions negatively, then it absolutely affects our tendency to take action on our projects as well. So at this point, the answer to this problem should hopefully be obvious. You have to create limitations for yourself. Good limitations reduce the number of choices that you have, which reduces analysis paralysis and makes it much more likely that you'll actually finish the projects that you take on. So here are 4 different types of limitations that you can apply to your projects. The first one is gonna be good old time limits and deadlines. I find time pressure to be one of the most action-spurring types of limitations that I can apply to any project, and it necessarily reduces the choices that you can make because you don't have very much time in which to make those choices. And when you're under time pressure, you often have to go by instinct, just go with whatever looks best. Now, this isn't always good to apply to a project. Some projects really need breathing room, really need time for you to kind of sit back and think and cycle between intense work periods and periods of rest where you can kind of ruminate on your progress. But if you find yourself habitually abandoning projects, then it can be worthwhile to go through the exercise of doing a project under a strict time limit. A great example of this is the ubiquitous 1-hour song challenge that you've probably seen here on YouTube by YouTubers like Andrew Huang and Jared Dines. A lot of these people have done this challenge, and while the songs that come out of it aren't always the best, it's a great exercise and it proves to them that they can make something that is a song in under an hour. And I actually used a deadline for my little Instagram song as well. I gave myself 2 days to finish it, and yeah, it's 45 seconds, but it's actually done. And that actually brings us to our second type of limitation, which is the scope limitation. It can be very useful to take on projects that have a purposefully limited scope, even if they don't seem as epic or grand as you would really like them to be. I actually made a video about this. It was called How to Make Progress on Your Goals, I think. And that video was kind of a case study of a couple of different people, Neil Stevenson, who is an author, and Matthew Thornton, who is a video game developer, both of whom kind of cut their teeth on smaller projects, which gave them the ability to tackle much bigger projects later on in their careers. And this is exactly what you can do as well. Oftentimes you're trying to bring together a ton of different skills that are all necessary to complete a project, but you haven't mastered any of them, which again makes the whole process kind of overwhelming. So if you take on tiny little projects, they are sort of like a training ground for you to develop your skills, make them habitual, and then apply them to more challenging projects in the future. Our third limitation is the limitation of the tools that you have available to you. And this can be really, really important, especially if you're doing something where you have a ton of tools at your disposal. As a musician who has a computer right over there with lots of virtual instruments and a bunch of real instruments sitting in this room with me, I have a ton of choice when it comes to composing a song. And that can be a bad thing sometimes. When I'm creating a song, I can kind of just get overwhelmed with the number of instruments I have at my disposal. So, with my little Instagram song, I used my acoustic guitar, which is my favorite instrument, and then I told myself I am only allowed to use one virtual instrument to kind of flesh out the song. So I chose a little virtual piano called Noir, and I doubled the chords that I used and just kind of added a little bit of low end, and that was it. In addition, with the music video, I could have used all the cameras, all the gear I have in the studio, but for me, music videos are something completely new, and as somebody who makes mainly educational videos, everything I've seen in the music videos I've watched has, again, been a little bit overwhelming as somebody who wants to get into it. So for this song, I told myself I can only use that one wall over there, and I can only use one single camera. That was it. And the interesting thing is when you reduce the amount of tools you have available, well, as they say, necessity is the mother of all invention. When you have a very limited tool set, you tend to use it a little bit more creatively. So that's another side benefit. Finally, we have a limitation that you may not have thought of before, which is to restrict your ability to undo. Now, being able to undo your mistakes can be great for many reasons, but it can also have a downside, because when you can easily just hit Control Z on any mistake that you make, then it becomes very easy to let perfectionism take over. Additionally, because you know you can always hit undo, it basically becomes impossible to get yourself into that slightly high pressure state where you know that there are stakes. And I think it's really important to spend at least some of your time in that state to feel like everything is on the line right now and that you can't hit undo. I mean, right now I'm filming this in my studio with nobody around, which means that I can flub line after line and it doesn't really matter. My editor's just gonna cut out the crap. And well, sometimes it's actually a bad thing. When I speak on stage at conferences, I don't screw up because people are watching me. I can't just edit things out. I have to get it right, which means that I honestly feel a little bit more eloquent. And there is something to be said for the analog methods that we used to use to create art. Back in the day, musicians had to record onto tape, which meant that they had to play their part right the first time. There was no such thing as overdubbing. There was no such thing as comping. And artists and authors had to do the exact same thing. An author had to commit to typing what was going to go on that piece of paper when they used a typewriter, unless they wanted to retype an entire page or use whiteout, I guess. And artists had to commit to the brush strokes they were putting onto their canvas. Either it was right the first time, or as Bob Ross would say, it became a happy little accident. But when you use a computer to create, you introduce the choice to undo literally every single action you take. And those choices can, again, overwhelm you. So if you really want to push your creativity and ensure that you finish, try restricting your ability to undo. Either do a project in a completely analog format or temporarily set your undo key binding to a keyboard shortcut that you're not used to. Now, you don't have to go overboard and use the limits on every project that you start. But again, if you find yourself abandoning a lot of projects and you want to see yourself finishing them more often, then try introducing some limits. Not only will this help you get rid of the analysis paralysis that is caused by too much choice, but many times it'll also help you think more creatively as well. And if you want to further improve that creative thinking ability, which can not only help you in your own projects, but in your career as well, then spend time regularly solving tough problems that require creative thinking. Brilliant is a great source of problems like these, especially if you also want to improve your mastery of math, science, or computer science. They have a library of more than 60 in-depth courses that guide you through these subjects in an active problem-based approach that throws you into challenging yet bite-sized and logically ordered problems that help you to stay interested interested, but also improve more quickly because you're working actively with material instead of just taking it in passively. In their library, you're gonna find a full math suite with courses ranging from algebra to number theory to more advanced things like probability and statistics, differential equations, computer science courses like Python programming and the basics of computer memory and even search engines, and science courses like classical mechanics and gravitational physics. So if you wanna start learning today and improving your ability to creatively solve tough problems, head over to brilliant.org/thomasfrank and sign up. And if you're one of the first 200 people to use that link, which you'll find down in the description below, you're even gonna get 20% off their annual premium subscription. Thanks so much for watching. Hopefully you found this video helpful. I know that this idea of using limitations has really helped me in my own work and in my ability to finish my own creative projects. So hopefully it is useful to you as well. And if you did find it useful, then maybe consider gently fist bumping that like button to show the YouTube algorithm what's up. You can also get subscribed right over here if you haven't done so already, and check out a couple of other videos on this channel, which will be somewhere on the screen. Hopefully not covering my face, because that's what I use to talk. But, you know, maybe right over here, right over here. If you smash your face into the phone screen, then you will be able to activate those videos and watch them. But if you don't want to do that, as always, go do whatever you want, because I'm not your dad.